no wonder why the city of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com. Hi, I'm John Malos. Welcome to this live edition of Connect With Me on the showroom floor at Ventura TV. On this day, it's a Wednesday, and we're talking politics. A man who wants your vote for City Council District Number 6. It's a hotly contested race. This thing is going on until June the 7th. That's when the state primary takes place. We'll see what happens. Three candidates up for grabs at one seat on the City Council. 436, MeTV, Option 11. Back in just a moment. And we're back here on the program today on a Wednesday morning, and thanks to McHenry Protective Services for their sponsorship today here on the program. A couple of programming notes. Tomorrow, we're going to have a man who wants to run for mayor of the city of Fresno, and so he's doing just exactly that. But more importantly, he wants your vote. H. Spees will be here to take your phone calls and answer some questions. And by the way, tomorrow at Fort Washington Country Club at 4 o'clock, I'll be moderating the debate. The mayor's race and then City Council District Number 6. That takes place from 4 to 6. I assume the time has not changed. At least that's what I've been told. And so that's tomorrow at Fort Washington. And tonight, I believe, at the Warner's Theater, the mayor of the city of Fresno, the current mayor, Ashley Swearingen, is going to give a little speech on the state of downtown Fresno. So if you want to attend that, there'll be a lot of people at that event tonight wanting to hear what the mayor has to say. By the way, on the program on Friday, we are going to have a new person who just entered the race very late, but she's in the race, District Number 5, Fresno County Supervisor's race there, the seat that Debbie Puchikin is vacating. And then the second half of the program, another guy that wants your vote for mayor, Doug Vagum, will be here on Friday. All right, and don't forget that special election, Clint Olivier, Joaquin Arambula, takes place on Tuesday, April the 5th. That's next Tuesday. You're watching us live every Monday through Friday, Comcast Channel 375 as usual. And I tell you this every day because it's just a quick, friendly reminder, not to belabor the point, but if you don't have Comcast Cable or Xfinity, you can watch us over the air broadcast 43.6, 13.1. If you have one of those digital antennas that you can purchase here at Ventura TV. And then if you can't watch this program in its entirety from 10 to 11 o'clock, you can certainly watch us on the replay at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 13.6 YouTube, 8 o'clock tonight, 4.6 Biz TV in primetime. And then someone asking me yesterday, do you post your shows on YouTube? Yes, we do, 24/7. You can watch 4 years worth of Connect With Me shows right here on MeTV Fresno on your favorite YouTube channel 24/7. So the focus today, once again, is politics in that hotly contested race in that District 6 race, City Council seat. Of course, that's the seat that Lee Brand is giving up so he can run for mayor of Fresno. That's another mayor candidate for you. But Gary Bredefeld, let's put his picture up on the screen, is one of those candidates. He's a former city councilman. Remember, he voted yes to build the stadium in downtown Fresno. That is an issue that certainly is talked about now. And Gary Bredefeld playing defense right now. When asked about that, he is vigorously defending his actions from 15 years ago to vote yes on that stadium. It's costing us a lot of money. Holly Carter is also running for that seat. She's not a politician. She's a newcomer to the scene, wants to get on board on the city council, she says, to try to fight crime in the city of Fresno. And then there is Jeremy Pierce, yes, the Elvis impersonator, there he is. He says he wants on board too because he's sick and tired of the crime in the east part of town, District Number 6. He wants to fix downtown, he wants to fix the crime, and all the rest. He just sick and tired of sitting back on the sidelines watching the deterioration of the city of Fresno, specifically in that area. All right, one of the hotly contested issues, of course, in this race is that baseball stadium. There it is right there, the Chuck Chancy Park. We had Chris Cummings here yesterday, the owner of the Fresno Grizzlies. What to do about downtown Fresno? How to draw more people in? Is the stadium standing there alone by itself enough of a draw to make a difference? It is the crown jewel, according to Gary Bredefeld. But really, is it, with no other surrounding businesses or retail to attract patrons? We'll talk about that with our guest today and how to revitalize downtown. And should we spread the wealth around Fresno, not just focus on downtown? Live in our studio right now is Jeremy Pierce. You know him from his Elvis impersonations. He does a great job at that, but he wants your vote. Fresno City Council, District Number 6. He's here again. 436-ME-TV, option 11. Please do call in. This is the monologue segment, my friends, so we're getting started right after the break, right after this, from McHenry Protective Services, our sponsor today.
Want to create something extraordinary? Create perfection. Our lifestyle appliances make it easy. KitchenAid, Ventura TV Appliance, and you. When only the best will do.
It's no wonder why the city of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com. Back here on the program, 436-ME-TV, option 11, McHenry Protective Services, our sponsor today. Once again, Jeremy Pierce is here. Good to see you,
John,
my friend.
John, it's good to be back. Thank you for inviting me. Doing fantastic.
Good. So once again, you are here, and you've had a couple of debates since you've been here with your two foes there, Holly Carter and Gary Bredefeld. What's been the biggest issue so far, in your opinion?
I think the biggest difference between us, at least Gary and myself, is the stadium. But what people really want to talk about is crime and homelessness and vagrancy. That's what people want to talk about. But they also want to talk about protecting our tax dollars. And that's where Gary's record comes into play. But public safety is paramount in District 6 right now.
So they care more about safety than they do about the stadium right now.
Well, you can't get where we need to be public safety-wise in hiring officers if you don't have the money to do it. And that's where they do talk about the stadium, because they know that if we didn't have that debt, that would be an extra 30 officers a year patrolling our streets. And so it does tie in. And but they're worried. They're worried. Wow. Vehicle burglaries are up 74%.
Rape is up in the district.
Yeah. Vagrancy is just exploded.
Home invasions are probably
Home invasions
up.
In northeast Fresno. I mean, it's a scary thing. People dressing up like they're from PG&E and coming in and tying you up. I mean, these are scary times. And if District 6 doesn't elect someone who's ready to aggressively deal with our crime problem, it's only going to get worse. And it's getting worse all over the city. Chief Dyer had a meeting a night or two ago in the Tower District where it's gotten so bad. And people are afraid, and I think that's where my call of 1,000 police patrolling our neighborhoods, it's the chief's call, and I'm the only one that's joined him in this race. That will make all the difference. Police presence deters crime.
But it'll cost a lot of money, and it'll take a long time to reach that figure of 1,000. I don't think it's ever been 1,000 officers since I've been in Fresno, and I've been here since 96.
Yeah.
Somewhere in there. I moved to Fresno in 1996.
We had 850 before the recession.
Yeah.
Now we're down to about 725. But that was before we had a smaller population, before Prop 47 prison realignment. But like the king saying, it's now or never. If we don't start now, we'll never get there.
Yeah, hey, we got a phone call already. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air. I'm so glad you called today for Jeremy Pierce.
Yes. My question is direct to Jeremy.
Yes.
I like the idea of him coming in because he's an outsider, really. He's got to get his issues out. He's got great ideas and just what I hear from him. But I do like the idea that if someone that's not been in politics and is willing to work with the people, and the people must understand his ideas, what he wants to do. You know, the stadium's a different issue. But besides that, the crime, like he's talking about, is a big issue. And downtown, it has a lot to do with the lighting system and whatnot. I hope when he gets in there, he can work with the city council, because that's what they need to, and not just be a favorite of the mayor or whatever, or, you know, this and that. You put your ideas the way you want it and pursue it, to let the other ones know how you stand. And the people will be backing you up 100%. So I love that you coming in. If you make it, for sure, you'll help Fresno. That's really what I want you to know, Jeremy. I'm with you.
All right.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. That's exactly what I plan to do. I have friends on the council already on both sides of the aisle. And I'm a relationship builder. I haven't burned a lot of bridges in this town. I'm relatively well-liked, and I have the city's best interests at heart. I'm a person that built a successful business and figured I'd just ride off into the sunset, buy a nice place out in the country when I was done doing my shows. But the thing is, not everybody can afford to do that. My friends and family would still be here. They'd be here with the crime problems and all of our other issues. And I didn't want to leave our city behind and our friends behind and our family behind. So I did a 180 on the plan of my life. Still doing shows. That's what pays the bills. But I want to help. I think I'll be an effective leader for the city. And if the people honor me with that opportunity, I'll roll up my sleeves and go to work.
Yeah. Let's talk about the crime issue, and that is so many of these crimes are happening in broad daylight, which makes it even more alarming. But let's talk about the Fresno Police Department. All right, you want more officers on the street. But most recently, I don't know if you've thought about this, but a recent article in the Fresno Bee talked about a major league morale problem within the Fresno Police Department.
Yeah.
Just major morale problems. Even Jerry Dyer has acknowledged it. An outside group did a study. They came in, talked to people in the Fresno Police Department, and their morale is down, way down. So, one, how do you fix that issue? Plus, to coincide with that, you've got two major lawsuits going against the Fresno Police Department that we know about. A current officer who says he's constantly harassed and discriminated against has filed a lawsuit. He's still on the force. It was in the paper about 2 weeks ago. And most recently, last week, the family of a man who was shot dead by police, an unarmed man last September, is filing a wrongful death suit, not only against the police department, but the officers who were involved in the shooting. So how do you fix all these perception problems with the police department? They're having problems of their own from a morale standpoint, and now, of course, lawsuit after lawsuit after lawsuit.
Yeah, the morale issue that came out in that study was shocking to see how bad that it was. And part of that is due to the fact that they're stretched so thin. When you can't get a day off for your daughter's recital or what have you, morale's going to go down. Also, the patrol division morale, particularly there, was low. It seemed at different times that people weren't being punished the same or given the same opportunities. And if people don't feel like everyone's being treated the same within the department, you're going to have that. You're going to have that in any business. And I think the chief realizes that. The chief is starting to make some changes. I heard him say on the radio that if you go to your wife and say, do we have problems, and she lays them out for you, you better be ready to address them. And I think the chief is.
What would you do and demand as a city councilman from the Fresno police chief?
Well, again, that he has his finger on the pulse of his department. I think that that he does. I think the study was a wake-up call, but I think Chief Dyer's done a fantastic job, particularly with limited resources since the recession.
But would you be, as a city councilman, would you be angry and making demands? You know, would you want answers to as to why this is happening?
Yeah, I think that we do have some answers, and I think the police chief is addressing it and not trying to sweep it under the carpet. And part of the problem, too, is that Fresno really isn't competitive pay-wise when you can serve in Dinuba or Clovis with a lot less risk on average than Fresno but get paid about the same. It's tough to attract officers here to Fresno.
What about the lawsuits?
You know, we live in a litigious society anymore, and some of that, what can you do? All police departments face some of that, and it's unfortunate that split-second life and death decisions are under the microscope the way that they are these days. But we have a countrywide problem with lawsuits, and those are going to be a part of life, and you just have to deal with them.
Yeah. Would you, as a city councilman, would you want to know more about these incidents that happened and why the police department is being targeted for these lawsuits? And with this recent shooting, I don't know if we have the videotape queued up. We do. Okay, go ahead and roll it. And just as a disclaimer for our viewers, it is very graphic in nature. Let's not play the sound, just the video. I don't want to hear those shots again. Very disturbing. But it's what law enforcement does. It's what they're trained to do. I know Chief Jerry Dyer also had a news conference of his own last week, separate from the families, and it shows the video here, Jeremy. Of course, department policy is, look, if you do not comply, then you're going to pay the consequences. Unfortunately, this young man paid with his life. He did not pull out a gun. He pulled out a nozzle from a hose. So, As a councilman, if you were on the city council, what kind of questions would you be asking right now, not only to Fresno police, but to other people who may have seen this happen? What answers would you want? What questions would you be asking?
Well, fortunately, we have the footage, which I think answers a fair number of the questions. Again, the officers have a split second to decide, and when they see someone reach for something, I mean, the whole thing is a terrible tragedy. Of course, this gentleman lost his life, and that's heartbreaking to his family, the officers that had to do their duty to protect us and to go home safe themselves have to live with this as part of their life. But the fact that the footage is here, I think, shows that once again, in these life and death split-second decisions, that they did the best that is humanly possible.
Yeah. Now, of course, the video here is all thanks to the body cams that the officers are now wearing. As a councilman, would you be in favor of these body cameras staying in place? Do you like the body cams?
I have split feelings on the body cams, and in cases like this, it's obviously helpful. I'm apt to give officers the benefit of the doubt, body cam or no body cam, but the other thing that it does is it's very expensive, and it's another thing that the officers have to do to download the video. It takes them off the street and so forth while they're doing that, and so there's a lot that goes into it besides just having that visual evidence. And when do you turn it on and when do you not, because there, you know, are certain times that you can't because you violate someone's rights and so forth if you turn it on at certain times. And so there's a lot of questions that go in, but in that case, obviously, it was helpful to see.
Yeah, it really was helpful. And Jerry Dyer is a big proponent of these body cams. He wants them turned on when an officer is involved in any kind of situation, whether it's pulling someone over or talking to someone, just so they have that evidence.
Yeah.
Because there are so many questions from outsiders. You know, people that look at the police department and their first thought is, they're guilty, they're not innocent. Why did you shoot that man? So they're not giving the officers the benefit of the doubt initially. And so I guess that's why he wants the body cams to say, hey, look, here's the proof in the pudding. We've got the video. Would you kind of agree with that? It kind of backs up the officer's
statement. Yeah, I mean, a picture's worth a thousand words.
Right.
You know, and so absolutely, it's when you see a video of someone reaching, I mean, it's pretty open and shut as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, because there'd be those doubt. There's still some doubters out there, even after the video comes out. But without the video, if an officer just says, well, he looked like he was reaching for a gun, how many, there are going to be half the people that are going to believe that, half the people that don't. And even with the video, you still have a lot of doubters, a lot of different ways to perceive that video. Would you agree with that?
I think there are some that where it's not quite as clear. I think that one is a little more clear, a clear reach. Some of them, it's grainy and they're shuffling about. And did he really reach? I think that one is a little more clear. But again, you know, some of them, even with the video,
there's debate, it's open even to with the video. Yeah, see, it's open to interpretation. So 436 MeTV option 11. A lot more to talk about here with Jeremy Pierce. He wants your vote for City Council District Number 6. He's running against Gary Brunefeld and Holly Carter. He's a newcomer to the scene, as Holly Carter is, but Gary Brunefeld, he's an oldie. He's been there before. He had his chance. He wants another chance at City Council. 436 MeTV option 11. McHenry Protective Services is our sponsor today.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Samsung big screen we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Time for that upgrade to an HD, 3D, web-enabled Samsung TV. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today.
Take a look at this. Let's play.
This is too hip for you. I'll slow down.
Let's play.
Watch all your favorite classic game shows on Buzzer TV, KVBC Digital Channel 13.7.
So who are you leaning in favor of? Who are you voting for in the election on June the 7th? Would it be Jeremy Pierce? Would it be Holly Carter? Would it be Gary Brunefeld? What's your preference at this point? 436 MeTV, option 11. In other words, what are you hearing that you like from each of the candidates? Are you hearing anything? Are you reading anything in the paper? Are you watching this show and hearing the candidates talk about various issues? If you are apt to call in, you can and offer your opinion, ask a question, whatever you'd like. And the question is, Jeremy, you know, not only talking about crime, but there's so many different issues that are facing downtown Fresno. And I want to get your opinion on one thing, because I found this hilarious. There are a lot of people in this city that support bus rapid transit. I'm going to get to the downtown issue. I know that's separate from crime. But before I talk about downtown, I want to talk about BRT, bus rapid transit. There are a lot of people that were in favor of it. Clint Olivier, that's his district. BRT, I guess, is designed to run faster, quicker, pick people up fast, and boom, it's going to go. There's no waiting. The theory is, by some people, that bus rapid transit will help transport more people downtown, and therefore more people will go downtown because of BRT. Do you believe that to be true?
I doubt it. I have my doubts. Now, right. You know, it's been voted in. It's coming. If I'm on the council, it will be happening. And so I hope it works out, since they've already pushed it through. However,
just because a bus runs faster doesn't mean more people are going to take it and go downtown.
Yeah, I really don't think the ridership's going to be there. And it's not just me. I talked to a city bus driver who was very frustrated, said, I told the city, as a bus driver, the ridership won't be there for this program. But
because, and what was his reasoning for
that? There's just not the demand. There's not enough demand to make a $33 million high-speed bus running up and down two streets work. Now, I hope I'm proven wrong, like some other things that are coming that maybe I didn't agree with, but now that they're in place, obviously, you cross your fingers and hope that they turn out.
Yeah.
But, I have my doubts that it'll be... the ridership will be there.
Who have you talked to in regards to this issue? Have you talked to any bus drivers? Have you talked to any
people? Yeah, I talked to city bus drivers, talked to council members. I was down at City Hall during the council debate on BRT. And I think I have a pretty good handle on the pros and cons and the reasons why people think it'll be successful. The problem is that transit numbers are down across the state. It's very, very hard to pull people out of their cars. Most people want to get in their car and go. Now, however, and I said this the other night at the debate, some folks rely on the bus system. And so we need to have, but I would have liked to have seen that money spent on the current bus system rather than BRT.
Right. So. Okay, got another call coming in here. Good morning. You're on with Jeremy Pierce. Go ahead.
Hi. I want to make sure that you can hear me.
Yeah, no problem.
Yes, sir.
Very good. You are very wise to talk to employees because most politicians and upper management ignore the ground level, and that's where everything happens. And I do wish you a very good job. And I will say that I would support you and absolutely would not support Bredefield because I have seen what he has done. Good luck. It's not going to be a fun ride.
Yeah.
I appreciate everybody that tries.
Yeah.
Do you have a specific question for Jeremy?
Honestly, yes. Here's one.
Okay.
What is your other profession besides being an impersonator of Elvis?
Sure. I got a degree in political science from Fresno State, went to work for a congressman, and then but my business, King Productions, is a full-time business that promotes and runs my 200 shows a year. In addition to that, we have a fan club that we run, 300 dues-paying members. We take groups of fans on trips to Hawaii and Memphis and on cruises and so forth. So it's a full Elvis business that's involved in a lot of different things. It's like most businesses, just a different end product.
Yeah.
But it is not the only thing that you have done in your professional life. And I don't hear about that very much.
Is there, you're asking if there's something else that I've done in my professional life?
No, you just said.
Oh, yeah.
You got free and that you worked in politics and you have a background other than just being the Elvis impersonator, which you do very well.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, I think that all of my life experiences from working in a congressional office to running my own business, that all of it put together gives me a base of knowledge that I think will serve me well on the city council.
Yeah. All right.
Anything else? I think that you might want to tell people that a little bit more, and I don't discount that you're a good performer. But yes,
sure.
You have the background for business, and you can take care of things if you are elected, and I wish you well.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate you calling in.
All right.
Good day to you and yours.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Who did you work for?
Congressman George Radonovich.
Okay.
And my wife did also. She was his press aide.
Okay. So. Okay. All right. So BRT, in your opinion, is not going to work. Let's talk a little bit about downtown, or do we have to go to break? Have to go to break? Got 2 minutes. Okay, let's talk a little bit about downtown.
Mm-hmm.
We'll talk about the stadium. Talked to Chris Cummings yesterday. Chris Cummings said that in the last, 45 days, I believe he said, he's been talking to a potential outright buyer of the team.
Okay.
Would you like to see that happen to relieve some of the pressure off the city?
Sure, sure. If the deal is there and we have a buyer, I think that would be fantastic. Of course, with the stadium deal, whether it was a bad deal or not a bad deal, we have to move forward and try to make lemonade out of lemons. So, I hope we can find a feasible solution.
Well, right now, the city is on the hook for about $2.7 million a year.
Yeah.
The Grizzlies are paying about $700,000 a year in rent.
Yes.
We don't know how much longer they can do that. And that's been reduced by half because 14 years ago when they first moved in, the rent was $1.5 million. And in the last decade or so, that's been dwindled down because Chris Cummings has had financial problems with the ownership group. He's had financial problems. So they've dwindled that down to about half. So if a new owner comes in, would you be a proponent of raising the rent? Yes or no?
I don't think so, because nobody's going to be able to pay that rent. That was like Major League Baseball rent. I mean, you know, and so I don't think it was unreasonable to think at the start. That was the problem with the baseball stadium deal, is the projections and the numbers that were put in there didn't add up to begin with. And so, no, I wouldn't be in favor of that, because they won't be able to pay it.
You wouldn't be in favor of going back to the original rent of $1.5 million if a new owner came in and had money.
I don't think it'll work.
Okay.
Yeah, I just don't think it'll work. I think that we're more where it reasonably could be paid. And so I think if we go back to it, they'll find themselves in the same position.
Well, what if a new owner came in and said, look, I got money, but I don't want to pay $700,000. I only want to pay $500,000. Would that be acceptable?
You know, I'd have to take a look at it. The city council, I would consult with Lee Brand for sure, who is the numbers man on the city council, and say, you know, Lee, how did you arrive at $750,000, and take it from there. But I think that they worked out a deal that hopefully will work for everyone at this point.
Was the stadium a mistake in your opinion?
You know, I guess.
Or is it okay now that it's here? Even though we're paying through the nose for it, it's $2.7 million a year for the next 17 years. In the end game, it'll be about $102-104 million out the door.
You know, I love the stadium. I do.
Yeah.
It's a great stadium. There's no doubt about that.
We all do.
Yeah. I go to games there. I've performed there. I've rented out facilities there for my own business use. So it's a great stadium. And I wouldn't even be at this point harping on the deal if Gary Bredefeld wasn't trying to come back. Because obviously the deal's in place. We have to, you know, deal with it at this stage. But the fact that's Gary's signature achievement, and it's really the worst deal in the history of Fresno.
What are you trying to point out when you talk like this about Gary Bredefeld? Are you trying to point out
that he's a big spender?
That he's a big spender?
Oh, yeah.
And what else?
Well, I think that's enough. Being in this situation we were in the city during the recession, laying off police and fire and not being able to fill in potholes and fix street lights and so forth because Gary got us into the worst deal in Fresno history. Again, I think that's enough. If you want to come back, you have to point to what you did before, and Gary was a big spender. And don't forget, John, not only did he get us on the hook for $104 million with the stadium, he wanted an extra $25 million for a lake down there. Can you imagine, after years of no maintenance during the recession, what that lake, Bredefeld Lake, would look like today? So he was a big spender then. He'd be a big spender if he came back.
Yeah, I think that was also the idea of Alan Autry. So I think they both had that idea about the lake. But Chris Cummings liked the idea about the lake yesterday. So I don't know. He said it's worked in other cities, and he pointed San Antonio to a city that's got like a similar to a lake, but walking the river. I don't know if you've been to San Antonio. But, caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Jeremy, a real quick question. Why is it, and if you guys get into the city council, I would like for you to do one thing and ask them why the city council. Why is it that most of the entertainment, concerts, and whatnot, basketball and all, go to Seymour Center I can remember bringing everything over here to the Stellan Arena because you got the parking, and it would draw a lot of people in, and it would help the stadium and whatnot. And as far as the stadium, why not bring entertainment like soccer and stuff like that? Concerts, and who's in charge of the entertainment, and why they ship everything over there to the Seymour Center? What would you do different to bring more entertainment back to the Stellan Arena, or right into, you know, where they can draw and see people coming in and say, hey, we've got restaurants, this is that.
All right.
That's my only question to you.
All right. We'll try to answer that on the other side of the break, because we got to take a break right now. It's the bottom of the hour. We'll talk about that SMG deal that deals in setting up concerts and events for both downtown and the Seymour Center. 436 MeTV Option 11. We'll be back with our program after this from McHenry Protective Services.
Find movies on Over the Air Channel 13.3. Movies. Our name says it all.
Services choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at McHenryProtection.com. All right, we're back here on the program, and the question is, why do so many events go over to the St. Martin Center and not downtown? This is a pet peeve of mine because about 10 years ago, or so, roughly so, maybe a little longer, there's a company, an East Coast company called SMG. Now, here's what I don't understand about this, and this has to do with government and city government. It makes no sense. Sometimes there's no common sense involved. They have one company, SMG, running St. Martin Center, which is out at Fresno State, and then they also run the Downtown Convention Center and Celland Arena, and so most of the events, like Paul McCartney, is going out to the Save Mart Center. So all the big events go out there, hardly anything is coming downtown, yet the city, on the other side of their mouth, they're promoting downtown and trying to revitalize downtown, trying to get people to come downtown for events down there, yet the events are going out to Save Mart. Henry Perea was here. He's running for mayor. He said the minute he gets into office, he, if he gets elected, he is going to fire or tear up the contract with SMG. How do you feel about SMG and their contract running both venues?
Yeah, you know, I'd like to look at their contract a little closer. I can see the idea of if you had someone that was just dedicated to bringing stuff to Celland Arena. That was their focus.
Right.
I could see potential benefit in that. And so I'd like to ask the city council, what's the benefit that you see of SMG handling both of them? But I think looking at it and seeing if it wouldn't be more beneficial to have someone solely dedicated to Celland Arena. Now, again, most acts are going to want to go to the Save Mart Center because it's newer, shinier, bigger.
But the acoustics are better, I'm told, at Celland Arena.
Yeah.
And the convention center than they are out there.
Yeah.
And I'm also told, and I get this from a lot of people about the Save Mart Center, is that the seating is very uncomfortable at Save Mart Center.
It's relatively
very tight.
Yeah, relatively tight.
And I never got that complaint at Celland.
Yeah.
So you would want to do what? Look at the contract?
Look at the contract, and I'd like to know why they see it as beneficial to having SMG do both, but I'd be open at looking at it because it does seem to make sense if you had someone just focused on Celland Arena itself.
Yeah.
And I have a soft spot for Celland Arena because that's where Elvis played when he came to Fresno, and so it's an Elvis landmark of sorts for me. And but yeah.
What year was that, by the way?
So he came in 73, and the evening show sold out so fast.
Did you go?
I was not yet born.
Oh, you weren't
born
yet?
But yeah, if I was born.
You would have gone.
There's me in my profession. And then it did so well that he came back Mother's Day of 74. So he came in 73 and 74.
To Fresno.
Fresno. It was gigantic. And they asked his manager why he came to Fresno. And he said because Elvis got more Christmas cards from Fresno in 1972 than any other city in California.
All right. Not long ago, a former SMG employee called in here and he said the signature events, the big events like Paul McCartney, that Save Mart Center gets priority over downtown.
Yeah.
Would you want that to change? If that is in fact true.
I don't think I could change it if I wanted to, because if it wasn't for Save Mart Center, Paul McCartney wouldn't come at all, likely. We didn't see some of the big, big names until we had the Save Mart Center. You started seeing Fresno pop up more on the radar, but that's for the really big concerts, the biggest names, the George Straits, the Paul McCartneys, the Justin Biebers, what have you. But there's a lot of mid-range ones that I'd like to see go to the Celland Arena, because they're not selling out some of those mid-range ones. They're not selling out at Save Mart Center anyway, and so I would like to see them go there and make it attractive to want to go downtown.
Yeah, but would you want the same company running both venues?
You know, I'm just not 100% sure. I wish I could say that I knew for sure the right way to go on that. But I'd like the city council to tell me personally, which I haven't had a chance to do, of why they think that that's the beneficial way to go. It, to me, I agree that it sounds like your sole job is to focus on Celland Arena. makes a lot of sense. So I would just like to hear why that would be wrong, you know, before I could say, yeah, I'm tearing up the contract.
Well, it makes sense that you need competition. It doesn't benefit downtown because SMG is not. It doesn't appear that, I mean, I don't know, I haven't seen the contract, but the problem is I should go, I think it's online. I think the contract may be online. I got to go to the city website and see. But it doesn't appear by the events that I'm looking at that are all going to Save Mart, it doesn't appear that any of these big events are going to Cellon. Maybe they don't want to go to Cellon. Maybe they don't want to go to the convention center. But it seems like the convention center and Cellon are dead in the water. Do we want that if we want to revitalize downtown? I don't think so.
No, absolutely not. And I think that some of it is just the function of, you know, Manchester comes in, that hurts Fulton Mall. Fashion Fair comes in, that hurts Manchester, what have you. And so I think, you know, that the newer, shinier thing, you know, always gets the most attention. But we need to find a way to make sure that Cellon Arena is getting its fair share of acts. Or again, why do we have it?
Let me ask you a question, because I met with a developer yesterday, and he's a big-time developer. And here's what he told me about downtown Fresno. And we can roll some Fulton Mall stuff. We can roll some downtown baseball stuff, which we already saw. We've already seen the stadium about 1,001 times. But here's what he told me. He said, look, you can open up the Fulton Mall. You can build this Terrence Fraser project all you want. No problem. He said, but here is the bottom line, and here are the facts. The fact of the matter is, the average salary for someone who lives downtown is about $25,000 a year. For everybody else in Fresno, the average is about $40,000 to $48,000. People who live in North Fresno, the average is about $75,000 a year. Someone who lives in North Fresno is not going to go downtown on a regular basis if there is nothing there. They might go down 2-3 times a year, but if they want to go down to a ball game, they're not going to go eat downtown, they're going to go to River Park. He said, so you have to build up downtown to the point where people who have money are living downtown. People who have money, builders, are building retail and housing downtown for people to do business downtown. And simply opening up a street on Fulton Mall, simply building this Terrence Fraser project, is not going to create immediate results. Would you agree with that analysis?
Yes, it's not going to create immediate results, for sure. People living down there, that is crucial, that more people live down there, the young professionals live down there.
But they're making less money,
you know,
and they can't afford to do a lot of things that the people in North Fresno are doing.
Yeah.
But the people in North Fresno are not going to be inconvenienced by driving 20 or 30 minutes downtown and 20 or 30 minutes back. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. And a lot of folks that when I knock on their door in Northeast Fresno, they're not interested in downtown, and they're not coming downtown. Let's be honest. The bulk of people in District 6 are not.
Is that what they're telling you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they say that. And it's the truth. And the developers know that by and large. But that's not really their target audience. What has to happen is people have to live down there. And they're building nice lofts and so forth where young professionals who are going to make a little bit more are going to live down there. Now, my view is that once you have kids and so forth, you're going to want a little space, and you're going to want a place for your kid to ride their bikes and so forth. But some of these younger professionals, these tech upstarts and so forth, I was down at Bitwise this morning, and if people get excited about that, want to be part of that scene down there, young professionals, and they're living downtown, I think for the first time, downtown revitalization actually might be right around the corner, and we're on the cusp of that, because I think there's a lot of young blood that's interested in downtown, young professionals that do want to be part of that.
But isn't it going to take years?
Yes.
This is not an immediate fix. It may take 15-20 years down the road.
Yeah, it is.
For this to happen. It's not going to happen overnight. Now, I know the mayor thinks that opening up a street and this Terrence Fraser project, fine, it's not going to have an immediate impact,
no.
Is it?
No, it's not going to have an immediate impact. It's going to be one step at a time, and I like what
I hear. It's like a baby step, right?
Yeah, it is. And I like some of the ideas that I hear of, we're starting small. We're not trying to go big guns. The other thing, too, is people have to feel that downtown is clean and safe. that doesn't get talked about near as much as just the numbers of it. And they've made strides there. They have to continue to do that, more baby steps on that issue, because if people don't feel downtown is clean and safe, they won't want to live there. They won't want to visit there, do business there. If your company's getting broken into night after night down there, that's bad news. If you're running off vagrants half the time and not dealing with your customers, that's bad news. So the city needs to make sure that they're making sure that the city is clean and safe for business owners, or it's going to be a disaster no matter what you build down there.
Hey, even if you walk from one side of the stadium around to the other side, you might run into a panhandler.
Sure.
People don't want that.
No. But they here's like the thing. It's happening all over town. You know, you can't go to Target, you can't go to River Park, you can't go to your neighborhood park without being accosted anymore. And so that's the thing. I do shows all over town. I did shows down near Warner's Theater, and it was it wasn't as bad as the Target not far from my house in Northeast Fresno, because it's the problem has scattered all over the city, and we better get a handle on our public safety and homelessness crisis before all of Fresno isn't fit to live in.
Well, here's the homeless encampments, which are now banned. This is old time video from the city of Fresno, and you know, they're banned all over the city. Of course, you can't do this anymore. You can't have an encampment, but that has forced many of them to spread out throughout the entire city of Fresno. Is that why we're seeing such a major rise in crime in Northeast Fresno, or is it more than just the homeless problem?
Oh, it's much more. Prop 47 is the biggest culprit, where they lowered a lot of felonies to misdemeanors. Prison realignment is another big factor. But there is a segment of the homeless population, and really they're the criminal vagrant section of that. The truly homeless that have serious needs, there are places to go for that. Matt Point at the Poverello House will match your specific need with services. The Fresno Rescue Mission has wonderful programs. But for those criminal vagrants, we absolutely have to deal with that in a different manner.
All right, got to take a break. Jeremy Pierce is here. Wants your vote, City Council District 6. McHenry Protective Services, your sponsor today on the program. Back in just a moment.
Tune in to Heartland for the best in true country music. Relive vintage specials, one-of-a-kind concerts, and country music's earliest videos. Heartland is the heart of country, the only place where you can find country music, country stars, and country lifestyles 24/7. Heartland, the heart of country.
Now on channel 13.2.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the Frigidaire Gallery appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy.
Time for that upgrade to an Energy Star qualified French door Frigidaire Gallery refrigerator.
Quality appliances for the way you live.
Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting.
Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise.
Back here with Jeremy Pierce, 436 MeTV option 11, 436 MeTV option 11. I'm looking here at some numbers that I looked at on the city website, Jeremy, and it has to do with the debt in the city of Fresno. Back in June of 2014, you had a debt of $831 million. In June of this year, it's going to be up to $843 million. How do you cut into that debt? In your opinion.
I mean, those are big numbers right there. And
I didn't realize it was that big.
Yeah.
But that's a lot of debt right there. So how do you reduce that?
Well, we have to look at restructuring the debt, obviously paying down the debt as our economy improves. We're going to have to pay that down. And the other thing too, besides paying it off, is don't add any more. That's been our problem in the past, is, you know, whether it was the Met Museum or Granite Park or the stadium, what have you, getting ourselves in these positions, because when you're paying that much on debt service, you don't have the money for the essentials. And that's what our campaign's all about. It's not adding to those numbers with more risky schemes, using the general fund as the developer's backstop. We have to be out of that business. Don't come to the city looking for it to be your banker anymore. I'll turn that away every time.
There's no question that developers, we need them to build things, but developers have their own agenda too, and you have to watch out for that.
Sure.
Because you never know what they're, well, I mean, follow the money, right? That's the old saying. So developers have their own agenda. But I'm getting to Terrence Frazier now, and I want to ask you about that deal that was recently struck by Terrence Frazier and the city of Fresno. Mm-hmm. But first, this call. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air.
Thank you. You're talking about the debt. The easiest way is I told the city council in 2013 on August to stop having the debt problem is like Mooney. Mooney Investments, they turned around and knocked our credit rating from AAA to AA because the council passes resolutions that allow people to get into them and use the money for anything and everything that is not required, such as $4 million for downtown structures, not over $9 million for the pay the bond and the back rent on Chichansey Park. Then they turned around and said, we're just borrowing the money from the two dedicated funds, especially for that, to pay those things. And the dedicated funds was DBCP plan, settlement fund, and the freshwater treatment plant that I was trying to speak against in August of 2013. It came out to a total of $159.1 million of credit rating we lost. I told them, close the loopholes that allows them to raid anybody's funds whenever they want to. If you're going to go along with this, then you don't need to be there. I'm going to be very blunt about it. We don't need any of the council members we have now except Sal Contreno. Sal voted against the proposition. And so that we could have Proposition W.
Okay.
And he voted, and he was the only one of the seven members of the city council that even had respected me enough to call back and talk to me. And that includes my District 4.
Okay.
Even District 4 did not want to talk to me. He doesn't want to talk to anybody. He will not leave a paper trail because he's a lawyer. Lawyers know paper trails can come back and haunt them later. So anyway, thank you very much.
Well, interesting.
I'll tell you one thing, John, and that is, and I heard this yesterday at the door, too. About the unresponsiveness of council members. Okay. Somebody said, I'm sorry I didn't call you back, but I don't have a lot of power anyway. I mean, what are you doing there then? You have to call people back. You have to listen to them when they come to
speak. Is that the main complaint?
It's a complaint, and also
is that one of their main complaints?
I wouldn't say it's a main complaint, but I've heard it a number of times that they're not calling us back. When we go to the council meetings, they don't pay attention to us. They're fiddling around with their phones or walking around or getting a piece of candy or whatever they're doing other than paying attention to the constituents who get 3 minutes to tell the council what's on their mind. They worked on this, and they come down there, and the council members aren't paying attention. That looks terrible. And like I said on your show last time, one of the things I'm going to institute are open office hours. You can make an appointment, come down there, straight to my office. Not an assistant, not a recording. You come in face-to-face. Jeremy, I don't like what you did. Or Jeremy, would you please do this? Or would you hear me out? We're absolutely going to do that every month when I'm elected. That's my pledge. If people vote for me, I'm going to hold open office hours, and you can come talk to me face to face.
What do you make of the water treatment plant that was approved last year by the city of Fresno? It's $250 million that the city of Fresno spent out there. It's supposed to serve the east side of Fresno, part of the 2035 plan. It's part of the east part of Fresno that's not developed yet, but the city eventually will develop it. I think Doug Begum calls it the land grab to keep it away from Selma, keep it away from Sanger. So we've been in a drought. Do we need a water treatment plant that costs $240 million?
We do. That's the kind of investment that is critical to Fresno's future. I'm not for throwing money around, but that is one of the wisest investments that we made. It's going to secure water for our citizens for the next 50 years. We've been paying for water that we're entitled to from the San Joaquin River and the Kings River. We had no way to treat it.
But it won't have an immediate impact, will it?
Well, nothing will have an immediate impact, but over time, it's we're going to be secure. We're going to be able to replenish our groundwater because we've been, until 2004, every drop for the city we sucked out of the ground. And
so
you can't do that forever.
So how does this water treatment plant solve the problems?
Well, the water that we're entitled to from the rivers, we're going to be able to treat and disperse to our citizens and not rely on the groundwater, which in like 1900, you could go down 20 feet and hit groundwater. Now it's like 120 feet, so that you can't do that forever. And so we had the Northeast treatment plant to start with, and that helped. But this one here, the Southeast Surface Water Treatment Plant, will absolutely set us up for the next 50 years.
Right. Okay. Caller, go ahead. You're on the air with Jeremy.
Yeah, quickly. You're talking about the water treatment plant, and that $9 million was taken out of that fresh water treatment plant fund to use as and to get, like I said earlier, for Chichansey. That totaled up right around $15.1 million that they borrowed, and then they turn right around and increase the debt of Fresno by $15.1 million to pay it off. You're robbing Peter to pay Paul with funny money.
Yeah, no, the fact
you
that we've
turn
been...
Around and do something right. You do not spend the money that's dedicated for these funds.
All right.
They're only one purpose.
Thank you.
But also, too, you want to solve a problem with the water in the valley? Get beavers.
Okay.
And stop damming up our water. Let it go to the end. It goes back to the ocean. It comes back to us as rain.
Thank you.
If you take all the water and dam it all up, then what happens? There's no water, no rain.
All right. Thank you very much, Jeremy. I don't know if you want to comment on that. And then look in that camera there and tell the people why they should vote for you.
Absolutely. We need more water storage, not less, to start with. But I'd like you to consider me if you live in District 6, because I'm going to aggressively deal with the challenges that we face. Our crime problem is out of control. Chief Dyer says he needs 1,000 sworn officers on our streets patrolling our neighborhoods to make the city safe. I'm the only person in this race that's joined him in that call. I'm going to bring an aggressive tough love strategy, as Mayor Giuliani did in New York, to our homelessness problem, where those who are truly in need, we push you toward services. Those of you who are criminal vagrants, we push you right out of the city of Fresno. I'm going to be the person that keeps an eagle eye on our tax dollars and doesn't get us in the bad deals that we've been in the past, so that we have it for water security, for our street maintenance and sidewalk maintenance, and public safety. So I hope you'll consider me. I will do my absolute best. I've turned my life 180 degrees from where it was to take on this challenge and to serve you, and I hope you give me that honor.
Yeah, and what's the biggest issue that you're running on? Number one issue in your mind in Fresno is?
Safety.
Okay.
1,000 officers to keep us safe. If we're not safe, the rest of this doesn't matter.
Yeah. Jeremy, I appreciate your time. I'll see you at the debate tomorrow at Washington Country Club. It's always good to see you.
Thank
back
you for
here.
Having me on again.
Yeah, and good luck.
Thank
we'll
you.
Try to have you back again
Sounds
before
great.
June the 7th. All right. Jeremy Pierce, want your vote. City Council, District Number 6. That's going to do it for us today here. More politics ahead in this, the remaining 2 days of this week, Thursday and Friday. Thursday, we'll have HB's here. On Friday, it'll be the latest entry into District 5, Fresno County Supervisor, and then Doug Vagan will be here on Friday as well. Have a great day. See you tomorrow. No wonder why the city of Fresno and so many Valley businesses choose McHenry Protective and Investigative Services. With over 50 years of experience in public safety and security, McHenry's team of experts will safeguard you, your commercial property, and your next big event. Professional service, marked patrol vehicles, 24-hour dispatch, and friendly, observant, and responsive armed and unarmed guards are just a few of the reasons you should contact McHenry at 559-478-7747 or visit them online at mchenryprotection.com.
When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice. But when you love the KitchenAid appliances we deliver, it's even better. Our website is cool, and it's a good place to start. But you really should touch the merchandise before you buy. Save big with KitchenAid. Right now, get up to a $1,000 prepaid MasterCard when you purchase select KitchenAid appliances. Get the best selection, price, and service in town without waiting. Come in to Ventura TV Appliance and touch the merchandise today. When you like Ventura TV Appliance on Facebook, it's nice.